didn't mean the pee, I'm thinking the Oreo. It just kind of happened. I was on a 7th grade field trip to Washington, D.C., and had just consumed a world's worth of Coca-Cola. Stepping off our Greyhound bus revealed a dire situation. The heavens had opened up, thunderous rain clouds pouring down on Abercrombie bodies. As onlookers scurried around the National Mall looking for cover, I faced a different challenge. I simply had to pee. My first instinct was to command the bus driver to take me to the nearest bathroom without delay, only to realize he would never do this as I was 12 and that would indeed be ruled kidnapping. Plan B. There must be a bathroom at the memorial. I'd been the only sad sack with a hankering for soft drinks pre-monument trip. Much to my dismay, bathroom flew off and I found myself with a decision to make. Pee on the memorial or pee on myself? And so I sat upon the stormy steps of the Lincoln Memorial, light emanating from the presidential facade, as rain poured down around me and proceeded to pee on a national monument. I knew I wasn't okay when I was very young, but I didn't know it was depression until I was much older. My early childhood was marked by migraines and mood swings, and an extremely heightened sensitivity at a very young age. I first read suicide in a 4th grade diary entry. Dear diary, today my heart hurts so much that I don't want to be alive at all, coupled with a stick figure drawing of me and a noose around my neck. Back then, I could never quite process the big feelings I was having. The great sadness I couldn't see in shape while the other kids played happily at recess. In my early high school days, I was a type A student committed to attending only the finest institution of higher education, which I eventually quit. The daughter of a school principal, I had been taught my entire life that I needed to do well if I was struggling to make damn sure nobody knew. As I entered 10th grade, my depression worsened. I wake up in the morning looking forward to nothing but going to sleep again later that day. Some days I regret waking up at all. Friends became acquaintances. I grew indifferent to progress, to the future. My sophomore year of school, unable to helpfully process what I was feeling, I took to self-harm to cope with my mental illness. I was invested in this mindset of too well on the suffer side of me. My twin sister eventually noticed, timing my showers and counting the blades of my razor to try and stop me from the cycle of harm. To those who don't understand, self-harm can seem counterintuitive. Why would someone who is suffering want to cause herself further pain? While I can't speak to the experiences of others, for me, self-harm is a way of reminding myself that I did not need to achieve perfection. The scabs and the pain were attention-committing reminders throughout my day that I was not perfect, and while others couldn't see it, at least I could reconcile it with myself. The spring of my junior year, I decided I'd have enough. Following knee surgery earlier that year, I'd saved enough painkillers for exactly this moment. I came home from school and emptied 2 bottles of Vicodin into my hand. Placed a suicide note on the pillow, thanking those who had made my life worthwhile and assisting to my family and friends there was nothing they could have done. I sat on my back on the floor and began to pray. For forgiveness for what I was about to do and for my life to be watched over for while I was gone. Then my phone vibrated. A best friend I'd heard apart from had texted me saying she noticed I was having a rough day and that though we were more distant, she still cared greatly and would like to talk anytime that I needed. I broke down softly. Flushed the bus. To this day, I'm terrified of only the sliver of love that saved my life. I learned that I can no longer stifle my mental illness. And it was after this that I learned life is full of far too many hardships to do anything other than what makes me and others happy. Living with depression is unfair. It's an unshakable evidence while those around you get to dance. But living with depression isn't always a curse. It has taught me to appreciate good things more. It makes me find beauty in sadness. Since my senior year of high school and thus far at Penn, my grades have been mediocre at best. I have very little to boast about for a resume, and my plans for any semblance of a career are non-existent. And yet I couldn't be happier. Now, I put my energy into meaningful friendships and relationships, and in pursuing not necessarily false success, but what makes me happy. In my case, that may be